As a teacher, I'm often asked what advice I would give to a new composer, or what's the one thing I wish I would have known when I was just getting into the industry. Well, I'm going to answer that, as well as unpack a brooding light tension cue on my week 30 Flog check-in. What is happening, YouTube? This is Dave Croft. Thank you so much for joining me for my 52 Cues vlog check-in. It is week 30, and if this is your first time joining me, thank you so much. I'm so glad you found the channel, however you found the channel. If this is your first time, I am committing to writing at least one cue for the entire year, and I've been talking about them, talking about the cues, talking about the lessons I'm learning, talking about things that are going on in the industry, in my life, or whatever. If you want to skip over the vlog entry and go right to the cue breakdown, you can check out the timestamps in the description below. We are talking about a cue called Fractured Foundations, which is a cue that I recently wrote during one of my Patreon music production live streams. We'll have more information about my Patreon at the end of the video. And as always, if you haven't liked and subscribed the video, it really does help composers just like you find the channel. So I would ask that you consider doing that. And if you don't want to, that's cool too. I'm just glad you're here and glad you found me. Like I said in the intro, one thing I get asked quite frequently is, what's the one thing you wish you would have known? And this actually ties into a couple of topics that I've talked about before. The first being the imposter syndrome video, which I've talked to several people, whether I know them personally or through comments or Patreon or on Facebook or whatever. This imposter thing is kind of a thing that happens across industries. A buddy of mine who is a very successful graphic designer has designed for professional sports, has been in the industry a decade and still struggles with that. And hearing from him, and it's just, like I said in that video, if you're struggling with that, that probably means that you're pushing into new territory in your life. The other thing that this ties into is, do you have to go to school and do you have to go to college to make a career out of this? And that points to the one thing that I wish I could go back and tell my past self. For the longest time, I felt like I wasn't a quote-unquote real composer, or I couldn't ever really make it as a film or media composer, or because I hadn't gone through like film school, that I was somehow missing something, that I wouldn't quite get there. See, I wanted to be a movie composer since like seventh grade, having heard Alan Silvestri's score for Back to the Future. I think that was seventh grade, whenever 1985 was. Hearing that soundtrack for the first time awakened in me the desire to be a film composer. And I wanted to get into that. I wanted to go to North Carolina School of the Arts, and because I lived in North Carolina, and in Winston-Salem, there is a high school which is for the arts, and they had a film music program, and I wanted to go there. But for whatever reason, we really weren't able to, to afford it, and so I just stayed in my public high school, and I think School of the Arts might be a public school, but I don't even know the real reasons why I didn't really push into it. My understanding was that it was a cost thing, which wouldn't be the last time that cost factored into my life's progress. So I stayed in high school. I went into the marching band, drumline side of things, really pushed into that, got really into kind of music theater in high school as well. But when it came time to thinking of college, a couple of schools kind of came to mind. One of them was School of the Arts because they had a bachelor's degree in film music. And the other thing was I wanted to go to Berkeley in Boston. I wanted to study film music, or I wanted to go to USC, or I wanted to go to a big college with a film music program. But Berkeley was out of the question because of cost. We couldn't afford it. My parents, they were both, you know, both working parents. My dad was retired from the Marine Corps and also worked full time for the post office. My mother worked for the Salvation Army. And so we weren't like super bloated. I mean, we weren't uncomfortable, but I mean, it was, we had three older sisters, family of four, and, you know, working parents and all of that. So, and I didn't really push it. And so it was just easier and more cost effective and to just safer. And not in a good way. It was safer for me to go to a public college in North Carolina, Appalachian State University, which I loved. I loved my time there. I have some lifelong friends who I still to this day keep in touch with that I met through there. So really, really, I met my wife there. I mean, that's I can't complain about having gone to Appalachian State University. But there was always this nagging thing in the back of my consciousness that was like, if only I had gone to Berkeley, if only I had gone to USC, if only I had gone to School of the Arts. And if I'm being honest with myself, part of the reason I wanted to go to Appalachian State was my sister went there, my mother went there, my grandmother went there. So and they're all teachers, and so I kind of came from a long line of teachers, and I wanted to kind of continue that. But it was really safe. I knew people, and I fundamentally, and my wife would absolutely attest to this, I have a big fear of the unknown, which points into my whole imposter syndrome. So like even like going to restaurants, I'll get the same thing because it's just like, I know it and it's safe and comfortable. And going to Appalachian State was safe and comfortable. I mean, I didn't even, by the time I decided where I was going to go to school, ultimately, I didn't even apply anywhere else. I took the SAT once and I got, okay, I got enough to get into App State. I'm good to go. I auditioned, got in. Yep. I didn't even push myself somewhere else. Now, is that like a life regret? I don't know if I would call that a life regret, but I definitely had the what if, like if I had done that, if I had gone to Berkeley and if I had gone to USC, if I had really thrown myself into film music, where would I be? Would I be on stage conducting, you know, orchestras in LA? Would I be somewhere accepting a BAFTA or an Emmy or an Oscar? Or would I be an orchestrator, you know, working in Burbank? I all of these what ifs have been kind of dragging me around for quite a while, for a long time, actually. And so I get into the path, wound up in Florida, had the opportunity to start composing music for TV, and then things super took off. Really, really took off. But regardless of how much success I had, that still was there. Like I always felt like there was a part of my world, whether it's my education or just faking it, like just making it up as I go along. I felt like there was always this thing missing because I hadn't explored what I quote unquote should have. And Shannon, my wife, told me one day in an epiphanal moment, she said, "Dave, you are doing the same thing that the people that did go to school, that did go to Berkeley for film music, have a doctorate in film music, you're doing the same job." And she was absolutely right. My career path had led me into the same gig that other composers, alongside other composers who had taken that route, the route that I thought that I had to have. And I had convinced myself for decades that I should have had. And that was huge for me. because here is my friends, plural, who one of them has a doctorate in film music, went to Berkeley, did all of that. And here's me, marching band, drumline, musical theater, master's in jazz, and we are side by side. And we're now collaborating. We're writing on the same albums. We're writing on the same projects. And that is when I realized, and that gave me the thing that I wish I would have known when I was doubting myself, that there are many paths to the same goal. Many paths in this career. It's not just one way. Going to film school, getting a doctorate in film music, going to USC, living in LA. Those are all different paths, but they're just a path. They're not the path to having a career in music. So if you're like me or past me, and you're sitting there thinking that there are all these missed opportunities, that if only I had this education, or let's even take education, if only I had this equipment or this sound system or these monitors or this plugin or whatever. Your path is your path. And as long as you are looking to better yourself and you are grabbing this, then you are making progress. It's all part of your Malcolm Gladwell approved 10,000 hours. In Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outliers, he talks about 10,000 hours, that it takes 10,000 hours to become a master. And if you master at something, so if you apply 10,000 hours towards something, you will master that something, whether it's diving or whether it's making music. Many paths lead to the same goal. Are there some paths which will equip you better in some areas? Undoubtedly. I talk about that in my college video about networking and getting the skills, but it's not the only path. But I wish I could go back and tell my past self just so I can appreciate the moment I was in, just so I could really, really soak it up and not look at App State as the safe choice, but the choice that's still going to get me to where I need to go. Because I look back on it and I can see all the dots connecting, you know, and that takes perspective and a little bit of distance. But I can look at this class, and I can see how this class led to that class, and studying with this teacher connected all of these dots to here I am today talking to you. And I can walk that all the way back to listening to the Back to the Future soundtrack on cassette, specifically the B-side, because that's the one that had the Back to the Future suite, because I had the cassette that had like Johnny B. Goode and Dance With Me, Henry, and all of those other songs that I kind of fast-forwarded through because I just wanted to listen to the score. I didn't have the score. I'm not even sure the score was available on cassette. So many paths can lead you to the same goal. And I'm here to encourage you, if you are sitting in that place playing the what if game, if only I had explored these things, then my career. No, pick it up and go. Go forward, find the dots, look at the dots behind you and see where the next thing is that can take you there. And stop lamenting about what was. I'm telling myself that, Dave, stop lamenting about missed opportunities or what you should have done, because before you know it, you're going to wake up one day and realize that you're standing shoulder to shoulder with the person who did do that, and you're doing the same job. So with all that, let's take a look at Fractured Foundations. It is a brooding light tension cue, so it has elements of light tension, but it's much more brooding, a little bit darker. So we're going to take a look at Fractured Foundations. We're going to listen to it, and I'll talk about it on the other side. Thank you. was Fractured Foundations. Like I said, a brooding light tension cue. So light tension elements, which is going to mean a really heavy use of melody, that synth undercurrent and really slow moving harmony. But brooding, it's got some textural kind of thing, some element of kind of drones and spooky sounds, some pitch bends, and that kind of thing. Also, this was written, like I mentioned, during a recent live stream. And one of the things that I really wanted to go for with this specific cue, and if you follow the channel, you know my unapologetic love of Omnisphere. That having been said, I recently picked up Complete 13 during the Native Instruments Summer Sale, and there were a lot of Complete 13 instruments I hadn't even explored. And so I kind of made a little mini challenge to myself to use a lot of Complete 13's new sound. That having been said, the Contact plugin, Contact, it's a sampler, and it's pretty beefy, pretty processor intensive. So I ended up having to freeze a bunch of tracks, and it was really, really good. Good, I say good, but it was a little sad. I'm on an older iMac, which was, you know, maxed out in 2015 when I bought it, but now it's 2021, and it's not really a RAM issue because I have plenty of RAM. I have 32 gigs, and that's fine. Where I run into issue really is my CPU, and this is a quad core iMac, but it's not like a 12, 16 core and all of that. So all that to say, if I run into issues, then I might need to refreeze some tracks. But I'm going to unfreeze it, see how it goes, and we will go from there. So like I said, light tension cues are going to have solid melodic elements to them. And so I'm loading in this lo-fi piano, which is taken from the Noir. Now, I had recently asked in a forum post on the Perspective forum or one of the forums about the best pianos, because I was looking to upgrade my piano. And so Keyscape came to mind, and that kind of came up a lot. But Noir came up quite frequently, and I see why. Native Instruments has done a really good job with Noir. It's kind of like a spiritual successor to the Maverick and the Grandeur, those pianos, more like the Grandeur. This feels like a Steinway. I'm not sure if it is, but it has a lot of the same types of things that their other piano libraries have. Namely, you can go in, adjust all the noises, adjust the realism. I will say that the pedal was a little squeaky. I had to completely remove the pedal. And while I applaud them for their realism for that, it was kind of unusable. So I have that lo-fi piano melody, just really kind of repetitive. And I did make a four-bar idea out of it. It's not just the same idea specifically over and over. I wonder why that's not showing up. There we go. All right, just to mix it up just a little bit there at the end to create a four-bar phrase, so it's not just a one-bar idea repeated. Layered it in with a second Noir piano. Up the octave. Then I brought in some synth bells, which I brought out some Zebra HZ. Because the Unfinished, Matt over at the Unfinished was running a special, and I couldn't say no. And his Omnisphere presets are so good that I thought that I would, I thought it would get me into Zebra. And so that's a whole other thing. Like, so just kind of this spooky kind of synthwavy type of a thing. And so these are all components of the melody. Brought in a lo-fi synth. This is a Cloud Supply, and I'll isolate each of these. This is the synth bells by themselves. And then I layered in this Cloud Supply, which they're doing a really good job with these play series. These are very usable usable sample libraries, and it's usually an A and a B. It's a layered synth that takes two samples and layers them together. And so then I have a low piano melody, which I believe is another noir, even further down. So you put all of these together and you get So that's the primary melodic motive. Now I'm going to go ahead and refreeze those, because I just know things are going to lock up on me. Okay, so all of my melodic content is refrozen, and in case you're not familiar, what freezing does, it's a logic thing, a logic ability where it essentially bounces the track into place. It renders it into audio, puts it kind of in the background, kind of hides it, but leaves the MIDI lane. So it's kind of like bouncing it into place in a non-destructive kind of way. And so when you go to unfreeze the track, it actually deletes the in this case, I think it's an AIF file, deletes the audio file. It's very kind of transparent. It's a really simple, straightforward way to go back and forth between rendered to audio and leaving it in virtual instrument space. So when you render it to audio, it disables the virtual instrument and kind of locks all of the effects and everything into place. So next up, we have Mallet Flux. I'd heard a lot of really good things about Mallet Flux. I don't want to say I was a little underwhelmed, but yeah, it was okay. It was okay. Getting into the arpeggiator, I think I need to spend a little bit more time. I just wanted to go in and kind of like designate exactly how long it is. So I ended up finding a 7/8 pattern because I really wanted a non-structured sounding. I wanted it to be a little bit more syncopated. And so also brought in a Hong, which actually is an Omnisphere patch. It's kind of a Hong drum or a Hong type of a patch. Yet another unfinished patch. And then finally, another synth. This is all my rhythmic, non-melodic components here. Oops. Another zebra patch. Right, I just wanted this high kind of tinkly stuff. So if we play that in context, then we get... It's all that. So that's how that fits in. Looking at my sustained sounds, I had a brass, this kind of brass bendy thing, which was an Arcus patch. And Arcus feels a little bit like Native Instruments' answer to some of the Spitfire libraries, namely like the Evo sounds and the Evolutions. It's kind of what it sounded like. Yeah, some weirdness going on with that. I'm not sure kind of what's going on. Could be the modulation. Or could just be having just unfrozen it. Right. So it was picking up on one of the sounds. So this bendy kind of pitch bendy thing. And then I brought in a pad in my B section, which is Farlight. And Farlight is another one of their play type instruments where they have two, an A and a B sample, and you can kind of blend them and do all kinds of crazy effects and blending. And I really like the Farlight and Straylight, but they are somewhat processor intensive. And that's really my only thing. You can see we don't have a lot of things frozen here, or we don't have a lot of things unfrozen. Essentially, a handful of sounds, and you can see it really pinging my CPU. just because whenever you have a plugin which is dynamically calling up different parts of the sample, you can see this guy, it's bouncing kind of all over the place, that just takes processor. And the more sophisticated these virtual instruments get, the more processor they are going to need. This brings us to our bass sounds. These are all the sounds that are going to be in our bass stem. And so we have a noir piano along with a low vox, which is another Farlight patch. I think it's the same one as well. Got a cloud piano, and this is a noir patch. It's really slow bloom to it, which I'm mega impressed with noir. Have a bass pulse. Which is a stray light patch. And so by itself, you can see this kind of dynamically pulling little sections of the sample, this all taking processor. A synth pulse layered on top of that, or underneath it rather. This is a lo-fi glow. Put all of that together. Oh, I also have a brass, low brass, which I've separated like I do with the piano. I separate low piano, low strings, low brass, separate them into their own track, so that when I go to stem out my bass only sounds, all I have to do is solo, and I don't have to go in and actually like mute MIDI. So putting all of my bass sounds together, which is a bit of a challenge to EQ, because I have to kind of give the low end to one of these sounds, and so also wanted to really coax a lot of the highs out of some of these others. Let's get some of these percussion sounds turned on. All right, so we have an Omnisphere percussion loop here. Which is this is actually a stock standard Omnisphere patch, drumming inside the piano. So they've gone in, and this was a suggestion from Chris during the live stream. He's like, hey, you should check out this patch. He knows Omnisphere really, really well, and he was not wrong. Great sounding patch. On top of another Omnisphere sound. With some damaged drums. This is from Damage 2, the Surdos. Actually, I think this is the World Traveler patch, so a lot of instruments all put together. With a gong. This is from Evolve's gong, from their gong and effects. Kind of my go-to gong. With some cymbals that I had recorded myself. Then finally, we get into some of the effects. And this is this China cymbal right over here that I actually bowed to create really, really interesting sounds. And you get that, throw some delay and some reverb, and it sounds really, really good. And this is that one live thing that I like to put on my tracks. I always try to record at least one live element. And it's unique. Even though I use the same cymbal several times, every recording is unique. And that gives that little twinge of that little layer, the veneer of authenticity on top of what are ultimately a lot of really synthetic or virtual instruments. I did drop in a reverse gong hit here. Oops, didn't mean to lock that. Along with a reverse sweep. And an impact in the middle of this kind of drop section. So again, what makes this brooding? It's all of these pads, this evolving sound, this percussion. It's all really, really filtered, and there's just this brooding quality to it. Pretty standard form, which I've talked about ad nauseum. You know, you watch 52 of these things, you're gonna see the same type of techniques get used over and over. Bring in the melody. Build it, add a layer of energy. Ultimately, that reaches kind of critical mass. Pull it back into the breakdown, build that back up until you eventually come back nice and strong. Yeah, so that is, or rather that was, Fractured Foundations. And I hope that was helpful. Hope that was helpful to see. Hope you enjoyed viewing that. Thank you so much for watching. If you made it this far, congratulations. I couldn't do this without the help and support of my Patreon patrons who give their actual real life money to make this channel possible. If that's something that you're interested in, patrons are, it's just a dollar and you get access to the Patreon page where you can ask questions and you get access, most importantly, to my music production live streams. I stream at least once a week. Here the last couple of weeks, it's been twice a week. I'll work on it Thursday afternoon, then wrap it up the following day. And they're usually anywhere between 2.5 to 5 hours total between the two sessions. So if that's something that you're interested in, please consider becoming a patron. If you don't want to do that, that's totally cool as well. I'm just glad you're here. Speaking of being here, if you haven't already, please consider liking and subscribing to the video and to the channel. It really does help composers just like you find my videos. So once again, thank you so much. I hope that you had a productive week 30. What are the things that you've told yourself maybe that got in your own way? I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. I do make every effort to read and respond to all of the comments. So until next time, happy week 31. Peace.